Hello students, so we'll continue from where we left in the previous class. The topic that we are going to discuss now is Negotiable Instruments Act 1881. This is chapter number 7. We are going to see what is the meaning of negotiable instruments, what are the characteristics of negotiable instruments, what is the meaning of holder in due course, and what are the privileges. Then what is a promissory note and essential elements of a promissory note. Then bill of exchange, essential elements of a bill of exchange. What is check, essentials of a check, and discharge from liability. These are the topics that we are going to cover in this chapter today. So we will first look at negotiable instruments and its characteristics. So negotiable instruments is a method of transferring a debt from one person to another. So for example, if you have if you want to do a transaction, if you want to give money to someone, you can use negotiable instruments instead of giving money. You can use negotiable instruments. That's the way you can transfer your debt. If you have to pay someone, that is your debt. This is the method by which you can get rid of that debt, by paying in terms of negotiable instrument. So what are the characteristics of negotiable instruments? So easy negotiability. We can easily transact, we can easily use a negotiable instrument. Title of holder free from all defects. The one who is owner of this particular negotiable instrument, there are no defects because it's very easy. The name of the holder is written in that. So the title is very easy. Transferee can sue his own name without giving notice. Even in negotiable instrument, we can sue our own name also, because that's the power of negotiable instruments. We may not even give notice to the debtor. Presumptions, there are certain presumptions before preparing a negotiable instrument. Certain things are assumed in a certain manner. Property, there is some form of property involved. Consideration, there is money involved. It is payable to order, which means we'll have to mention who do you want to pay it to. And finally, it works as a payment. So these are the features of negotiable instrument. Negotiable instrument is nothing but a document which can be used in place of money also. So it's a transaction related document which can be used for purposes of bringing transaction into practice. Now we'll look at what is the meaning of holder in due course and what kind of privileges does holder in due course have. So the holder in due course means any person who for consideration became the possessor of a negotiable instrument. So suppose there is Mr. A. He sold goods to Mr. B for rupees 50,000. Okay, now he gave the goods to Mr. B and he is expecting to receive money from Mr. B. Now Mr. B appoints his brother Mr. C and he tells him, go and give this 50,000 rupees to Mr. A. Okay, so in that case there is a mediator that comes into picture. Okay, and that person is called as holder. Now when it comes to money, when it comes to real cash, there's no problem. But when it comes to negotiable instrument, the person has to be very careful. So if Mr. B is giving a check or a bill of exchange or a promissory note in the hands of Mr. A and he tells him, okay, go and deliver it to Mr. A, then Mr. C becomes holder in due course. So the holder in due course means any person for who consideration became the possessor of a negotiable instrument. Now what are the privileges that a holder in due course might exercise? Better title than that of transferor. Now see, if I give you a blank check and I tell you, go and give it to the person, then the moment that blank check is there with you, you become more powerful because it's a blank check and you can anytime mention your name in that, and you can take that check in your name also. So you are in a better position than the transferor. Liability of prior parties. So as a holder, you have a liability of your prior party. So if Mr. C is moving ahead, he has to bear the liability of Mr. B, and he has to take it accordingly. Then privilege in case of fictitious bills. In case the bill is fictitious, if it is not, it is just for namesake, then there are very few privileges, there are very few advantages that he can take. Absence of consideration. If there is no consideration, then definitely holder in due course can take some advantage. Conditional delivery. In fact, only when the goods are received, holder in due course will be free from the responsibility of delivering the check to the party. So there has to be a conditional delivery, that only if this happens, then we can collect the check. Instrument obtained by unlawful means or by unlawful consideration. Again, it will not be considered. Anything that is unlawful consideration or unlawful means is not available. Every holder is a holder in due course. So in due course means till the time the check is delivered, it is due course. So every holder is actually a holder in due course. By the time the check reaches, so you are no more holder in due course. So that's what the meaning of holder in due course is. Now we look at first negotiable instrument, that is promissory note and essential elements of a promissory note. Now see, a promissory note is an instrument in writing containing an unconditional undertaking signed by the maker to pay a certain amount of money only to or to the order of certain person or to the bearer of the instrument. So what are we trying to say here is that suppose I have to pay money to, let's say, Mr. Ajay, and I prepare a note, I prepare a small letter, okay, and I write on it I promise to pay rupees 5,000 to Mr. Ajay or his order, okay, whatever, on this date, on say 10th of October 2021. I promise, that's a promissory note. So now it is a negotiable instrument, which means it becomes powerful, it has money attached, and whoever is looking for money, if I write it down and sign it and give it to that person, then that will be a promissory note. So it is just a normal letter where we write that we promise to make a payment. Now, before making a promissory note, what all things have to be taken care of? It has to be in writing. So it cannot be oral, it has to be writing. In that we have to mention that, okay, we will pay, we have to agree, we have to promise that we will pay. It comes without any condition. We cannot mention a condition. It has to be signed. It also has to mention a purpose, that okay, I'll make a payment of rupees 10,000 to you for the mobile phone that was sold to me. Okay, so write a purpose. It has to have a specific sum, that okay, this is the amount, okay, 10,000, 5,000, 4,000, whatever. It has to have a specific sum. And the promise has to be there only to pay the money, not anything else. And there has to be stamping. Stamping means a stamp paper has to be used. So these are the essential elements of a promissory. So when you take a normal stamp paper and you write this statement there, I promise to pay Mr. Ajay rupees 5,000 on or before 10th October 2021 for the purpose of purchasing his mobile phone. I've written everything, it's on a stamp paper, and I sign it. There are no conditions in it. So this is an example of a promissory note and the elements of promissory note. We'll look at next negotiable instrument. We'll talk about bill of exchange and essential elements of a bill of exchange. So let us understand what is a bill of exchange. So I'll give you one scenario, I'll give you an example. So Mr. A sold goods of rupees 10,000 to Mr. B on credit. Okay. So Mr. A has sold goods to Mr. B of rupees 10,000 on credit and agreed to receive the payment after 2 months. Okay, so he sold the goods on, let's say, 1st of May, and he agreed to receive the payment after 2 months. Now this is a credit transaction. So Mr. B is saying, I don't have money, so please give me a couple of months. So Mr. A says, see, I don't mind giving you a credit period of 2 months. There is no problem in me giving you a credit period of 2 months. But the thing is that I need to have a proof. I need to have a written documented proof that you will be paying me the money after 2 months. So I need that, some document I require. So then a bill of exchange is prepared where we write, okay, 2 months after 1st May. Okay, 2 months after 1st May, pay to me, rupees, me or my order, rupees 10,000 for the value received. Like this, a document is prepared on a stamp paper. So in that, an amount is mentioned and names of the parties are mentioned. So the person who is selling the goods is called as a drawer. And the person who is buying the goods is called as a drawee. The one who drafts the bill of exchange is called as a drawer. So seller draws the bill of exchange. So I will bring a stamp paper. I will write all the details. I will write the name of the drawee. I'll write my name. I'll sign. I'll ask the drawee to sign. I'll prepare an official document. Now that official document is actually called as a bill of exchange. So for me, that bill of exchange is called as bill receivable. And for the person in front, that bill of exchange is called as bills payable. So a bill of exchange is an instrument in writing containing an unconditional order. It's an order signed by the maker. Maker is a drawer, directing a certain person to pay a certain sum of money only to or to the order of a certain person or to the bearer of the instrument, whoever is the holder of the instrument. So it's an official legal document. That's how a bill of exchange works. And it can be used in place of money. So when I get that document from the drawee, I'm relieved that okay, now he has given me a promise, he has signed the document, and he has agreed that okay, he will pay that amount. What are the essential elements of bill of exchange? It has to be in writing. There has to be minimum two parties. Okay, there has to be an order to pay. Someone has to order. It has to be unconditional without any condition. Signatures have to be done. Drawee's name has to be mentioned. Money has to be mentioned. Now, in some cases, there is a concept called as pay. Let's say, I want Mr. B to make this payment, not to me, but to Mr. C. So, C becomes pay. So, I will write in that bill of exchange that pay to C or his order, not me. You pay to him. So, in that case, drawee will make a payment to the pay. Then, certain sum. So a document like bill of exchange, when it is prepared, it has all these details. These are the essential elements of a BOE, bill of exchange. Okay, so we'll move to the next instrument, check. Now see, we all are very well aware of what a check is, and we'll talk about check in detail also. We all are aware, we know how checks are used. So check is an instrument drawn on specific banker. So it's rather an order to the bank. So suppose I have a checkbook with me of, let's say, HDFC Bank. So I'll pull out a leaf from HDFC Bank and I'll write the name of the person to whom I want to transfer this. Okay. So let's say I want to transfer it to my friend Ravi, who has an account, let's say, in ICICI Bank. So I've drawn a check and I've written his name also there and I've written the amount. And I now give that check to him. He will go and deposit that check in the ICICI Bank. Now, ICICI Bank is going to call my bank, which is HDFC Bank, and ask whether this is the check which this person has issued. Is this a right check? And the bank will confirm, yes, it is the right check. And now, bank will consider this check as my order to HDFC Bank to make a payment to ICICI Bank and a further order to ICICI Bank to make the same payment to my friend Ravi. This is how it works. So check is an instrument. It is drawn on a specific banker, ordering them to pay specific amount to specific person after specific date. Okay. So this is what simple is. You all must have seen a check definitely. What are essentials of a check? You can't have a oral check or something. It has to be written. So it has to be a written format. An unconditional order, which means without any conditions, on a specified banker, that the check has to be addressed to a bank. amount should be there, money should be there, payee has to be certain. You have to decide who you want to make this payment to. Your sign is extremely important. So this is all it is. Sometimes you can also cross a check so that the account, the amount directly goes into the account. So when you cross a check, on the top left corner, you have to draw double lines and you have to write account payee. Even if you don't write account payee, if you draw two lines, it is understood that you want this amount to be directly deposited to the account of the holder. So that's how a check works. So this is what is check, and these are the essentials of a check. Now, discharge from liability. Now, what is the meaning of this term? How to get free from a negotiable instrument? You saw three negotiable instruments. You saw a promissory note. You saw a bill of exchange. You saw a check. So these are three documents which are as good as a check, as good as the amount. So how do you get a discharge from the liability of having such negotiable instrument? How do you get free from such a liability? Okay. So the logic here is that you make a payment. It's very simple. So you pay the amount and you're free. Okay. So if you have the negotiable instrument, okay, and let's say you want your money, you can show that negotiable instrument to the right person and you can get your money. Once the person makes a payment, the liability is just discharged and that negotiable instrument is of no use. It can be further destroyed or whatever, but it is of no use because the payment has been made and the liability has been totally discharged. So there's no burden on anybody. The other method is by cancellation, which means if I am the one who has drawn a check on you and I only cancel it, I mean I call the bank and tell that this check number has to be stopped, or I want to cancel this check. So even if you go and deposit it in the bank, in your bank, my bank will tell your bank that no, this check has been stopped, it has been cancelled, and now you cannot materialize the transaction. So what happens is here, you are discharged from the liability. In fact, if you are drawing the check, you are drawn discharged from the liability by release. Release is by not actually giving, only by not giving it to you. Okay, so if you don't give it, then you are automatically released. There's no burden on you to fulfill that. By default of the holder, if holder deposits it to a wrong account, then that is a problem where the liability gets discharged. By material alteration, if there are changes made in the check, there is a high degree of problem where you have made changes, you have made changed the date, you have changed the sign, or you make any changes, change the amount, then automatically you get a discharge from the liability. And finally, by operation of law, if the law decides that no, this is not valid anymore, if the law tells that this is not legal anymore, then automatically it gets discharged. So these are the ways by which we can get discharged from liabilities. Now, this is where we come to an end of the chapter on negotiable instruments. I'll quickly run through what we have covered so far. So we saw negotiable instruments and its characteristics. We saw what is the meaning of holder in due course and what are the privileges. We saw what is the meaning of promissory note and essential elements of a promissory note. Then we saw what is the meaning of bill of exchange, essential elements of a bill of exchange, checks and essential elements of a check. And finally, we learned about discharge from liability. So now we'll move to the next chapter, that is arbitration and conciliation. It's a very short chapter. There are some basic details about arbitration and conciliation. We'll try to understand that and we'll try to finish this chapter also. So we'll see what is the meaning of arbitration and what is the meaning of conciliation. So arbitration is a reference to the decision of one or more persons, either with or without any umpire of a particular matter in difference between the parties. Okay. See, what happens is because we are dealing into business laws, because there are many transactions happening, there are chances of having disputes. Okay, so in terms of disputes, suppose if there is a transaction that was decided that Mr. A will sell his car for rupees 3 lakhs to Mr. B. This is the transaction. Now, due to some reasons, there is a dispute, there is a fight, and they are not willing to go ahead with the transaction, and okay, there's a problem. So while preparing a contract only, they mention that, okay, if something like this happens, if there's a dispute that happens, then we will get it arbitrated. Arbitrated means we get it solved. Okay. But we will solve it again, mutually coming to a conclusion. We will solve it by arbitration. We will solve it by sitting together. We solve it by keeping the facts in front of us, and rather than beating around the bush. So we'll come to the point directly. That is arbitration. Conciliation is a form of alternative dispute resolution in which a neutral third party hears both the sides. So what happens is, here we have a conciliator, a third person comes into picture, and the third person will now listen to both of the parties. So he will sit in between and he will listen and he will decide, he will give a judgment whether who is right and who is wrong, and this decision will be taken. So arbitration and conciliation is actually a dispute resolution methodology. So either you do it by yourself, talking amongst yourself, chatting with you, talking with you, each other, sitting down, finding a mutual solution to this problem. Either you do it, or you have a third party coming into picture who will become a mediator, try to neutralize things, try to mutualize things, like that. That is arbitration and conciliation. Now, a third party, when he comes, it is called as an arbitrator. It is actually called as an arbitrator. And there are certain duties of an arbitrator. So, an arbitrator is a third person who comes into picture to solve this review, debate the problem which has happened. He's come here to solve that. And with the help of conciliation, he'll be able to solve it. Okay. So what are the duties as an arbitrator? When you come as a middleman, when you come as a middle person to solve a dispute between two people, you have to be independent and impartial. So what does that mean? Independent means your decision should not be dependent upon the behavior of the other two people. So your decision should be independent of any discussion that has happened. As a mediator, as an arbitrator, you have to be impartial. So you can't be doing partiality. You have to be impartial. There has to be no differences between the... there's no favoritism here, or there's no supporting any one team here. So you have to be independent. You have to be impartial. Fairness and justice. So you have to remain fair. You have to remain just. Even if you feel that the decision is not going according to what you think, but the other way, the decision is fair and just, you'll have to go for a just decision. A justice has to be done. Equal treatment of parties. So it is again the same point. You have to treat both the parties as equal. There's no one who's bigger or smaller or richer or poorer. So you have to think that both the parties are equal. You have to treat them equally, and the whole dispute resolution also has to happen in an equal manner. Adherence to the rules of natural justice. So again, it's a part of justice. So whatever are the rules required to bring justice have to be followed. So if naturally justice is to be given, those rules have to be followed without fail. Confidentiality. Confidentiality means keeping the things within yourself. So you need not tell what kind of a dispute is there, why are these two people fighting. You have to maintain that information with yourself, and you have to keep it with yourself. And disclosure of information is you have to disclose information to each party, what one party is thinking, what other party is willing to come down to. That clarity in disclosure of information has to be there. So as a middleman, these are going to be the duties of an arbitrator. Now we look at procedure of conciliation. Procedure of conciliation. So we'll talk about that. So we are looking at commencement of conciliation. So this is the first step where the conciliation begins. So if you have to become a mediator, if you have to become an arbitrator, you have to start conciliation at some point. Now, how do you know that there is a requirement of a conciliation? So whenever there is a dispute between two parties, these two parties will find someone to become a mediator. These two parties will find someone to try to solve this problem by conciliation. So you will be approached as a conciliator. So when there is a dispute between two parties, what actions do they take? What do they do? So if let's say Mr. A had a contract with Mr. B of selling his car to him for rupees 2 lakhs. Now this is a contract, plain contract. Now after some time, when they have agreed into a contract, they don't want to get into the performance of it. Mr. A doesn't want to give the car, Mr. B doesn't want to give the money, and there is some dispute here. Or they want to do it, but there is some dispute here. So according to the agreement and the contract that they have made, in that they have written that if there is a requirement, they will go for conciliation. So they as parties will approach conciliator, the third party. So the first step is approaching the third party. Then the third party will start the conciliation. He will come, he will meet, and that person will start the conciliation proceeding. So he will take all the details from both of the parties and, you know, start making a document. Okay. Once he is done in all research, he will ask both the parties to submit a statement back to the conciliator. So party A will write, okay, I have these problems. Party B will write, I'll have these problems. So they will both submit their statements. Now he has done his own research, both the parties have submitted their statements to the conciliator. He will do his own research and he will call both the parties together on a single platform. When he calls both the parties, he will actually conduct the whole conciliation proceeding. So he will openly bring the topic on the table. He will start having discussion among both the parties, and he will try to resolve it. And finally, they will get an administrative assistance, which means legally a conciliator will be able to help, an arbitrator will be able to help. And legally someone would be able to give them assistance through legal documents, through legal methods, through legal proceedings. So this is the whole procedure of conciliation. So it is stepwise planned, which is first you both the parties have to finalize who is going to be their conciliator. Conciliation will begin. There will be submission of statements by both the parties. There will be conducting of conciliations, conciliation of proceedings. And then finally they will receive an administrative assistance by the conciliator. So students, this is where I end this chapter. I'll quickly run through what we have discussed under arbitration and conciliation. We have seen what is the meaning of arbitration and conciliation, what is the difference between both, what are the duties of an arbitrator, what is the procedure of conciliation. So this is what we have seen. So with this, students, I am done with the whole subject, business regulatory framework, that is also called as mercantile law. So I would like to thank all of you for listening to me so patiently. These are my personal details. In case you want to get in touch with me for any future related work, so my name is Professor Yogesh G. Nagpal. My contact number is given here, my email address is also given here. And the motto that I follow is success follows excellence. It's been a good, great journey with me for all of you to learn business regulatory framework through me. So with this, I would like to wish all the best to you for your exams. I don't know when are they going to plan to conduct, or if there is any assistance required from your end, if you need my help per se, my contact number is there. It is there on WhatsApp also. My email is active. Even you have got my official email through the college. So you all can get in touch with me with this. I would like to end the session for today. Thank you so much, and all the best.